Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents The Morrigan, Celtic Goddess of Magic and Might, by Courtney Weber. Foreword by Laura O'Brien. Narrated by Wendy Tremont King. There are rough places yonder, where the men cut off the mast of Maka, where they drive young calves into the fold, where the raven women instigate battle. Dub Ruish. Foreword. I was working as a waitress in a cocktail bar when I met Courtney Weber. Nah, just kidding. But by that line, you will understand that to work with the Morrigan as directly as I have, for as long as I have, you need a bloody good sense of humor. And sometimes it fails you, as it did with this terrible opening joke. So, let's begin again. I was working as the manager of the Rockrochen Visitor Center, then called the Krochen E. Heritage Center, in the medieval village of Tulsk, County Roscommon, when I met Courtney. Being the general manager of an internationally important archaeological and mythological complex of sites is not an easy job, especially when it seemed you were one of the few in the region who placed a high value and esteem on the sites. Around the time I met Courtney, I had a lot of balls in the air, just trying to keep the doors open and the lights on and the local people happy, never mind my nefarious plans for world domination. A long, long time ago, in 2002 to be exact, I moved to Roscommon and began to develop relationships with some of the sites and many of the spirits within the Rockrochen complex. In the lore, Rockrochen is recorded as being the location of one of the three great fairs of Ireland, as well as being one of the island's three great heathen burial grounds. It's where our national epic saga, the Town Bo Cuilne, the cattle raid of Cooley, started and ended. It's the royal seat of the great warrior Queen Maeve of Connacht. Most importantly to our story, though, is the entrance to the other world, described by medieval scribes as Ireland's gate to hell, but most often called Uiv na Gut, Cave of the Cats, anglicized to Uwain na Gut. This is the fit abode of the Morrigan, and this is where I eventually ended up. Sure, what else would you do when your one-year-old nephew is suddenly taken gravely ill? You too, my friend, would head to a known place of power to communicate with the gods of your land and maybe cut a deal, or maybe you'd sit quietly and pray. I don't know. But in that situation, I headed underground. I was hoping for Dienkecht, to be honest, or maybe Ermet. She seemed nice. I was definitely there for the healing vibes. You probably already know who actually showed up, though, and are thinking, well, Laura, what did you expect, going to the Morrigan's cave looking for help? I just wasn't thinking clearly, maybe, and I definitely didn't know then what I know now. I really was just expecting some plain old Tuatha De Danann help, but she showed up and made an offer, which I negotiated a little. Me working for her for the rest of my natural life? Fine. Me promising her a stake in anyone else's future? Nope. Not mine to give. And then accepted a life for a life. And that, my friends, is how I ended up in Rockrochen, working for the Morrigan, and shortly after walking entirely unqualified into that management position at the center. That's where Courtney steps back in. Folks, she seemed very young and was a devotee of Bridge. I could definitely feel that one's fiery breath rolling all over the poor woman. I have a different perspective on Bridge than many others. But over in the shadows of the corner, another was watching. I stepped in to speak to the group leader, a friend of mine from way back, and I felt her, the queen, step with me, guiding me to sit with the red-haired lass at the middle table. We talked a little, and suffice it to say, I gave her group some time that day. Now, maybe Courtney wants to tell you of her experiences in Uivnagat that day, or in the days since. And maybe she doesn't. Those aren't my stories to tell. But you'll be lucky if she does. You can learn a lot now from our Courtney. She speaks truth and walks with honor. I'd like to think that way, way back, I played some small part in opening the gates to her, for finding the wisdom of the West in a dark cave at Cruachan. That's why I was delighted when she invited me to open this book for ye all. It feels a little like we're spiraling back around, but going deeper. I hope you enjoy the journey. Is Misha Lemos, Laura O'Brien, Era, 2018. Chapter 1. Meeting the Morrigan. She is the spirit of fury and peace, power and destruction, joy and terror. She is warrior, queen, death omen, mother, murderer, lover, spy, conspirator, fairy, shapeshifter, healer, and sometimes the living earth itself. A captivating contradiction. A demonic female who both haunts and heals. Benevolent in one moment, ghastly the next. And kind the moment after that. Meet the Morrigan. When I was a child, I broke a thermometer. Amazed, I chased the shiny pools of mercury around the bathroom floor with my fingers, becoming frustrated when they beaded and blobbed beneath my touch, but escaping whatever shape I hoped to create. But after a little while, the mystery of the substance was its fun, beautiful and fascinating, but always slightly out of grasp. The mercury on the bathroom floor mirrors my journey with the Morrigan, an ever-shifting, enigmatic goddess, both captivating and terrifying. Some might argue that, like trying to hold liquid mercury, fully grasping the Morrigan is dangerous. But this is where my metaphor ends. Mercury is toxic, but the Morrigan is not. Few goddesses attract as much reverence and notoriety as the Morrigan. Her earliest references describe a shrieking, cursing being who laughs at misery, one sometimes aligned with demons of the Christian hell. Medieval writers and contemporary bloggers alike describe a treacherous goddess. Yet, while scrolling social media or sharing mead around festival bonfires, I read and heard stories of how the goddess with the warning label changed lives for the better. I wondered how a goddess known for terror could also be restorative. Eventually, I would understand. To begin, who is the Morrigan? To the best of our knowledge, the Morrigan originated in Ireland during the Celtic era, which took place from roughly 1000 BCE to 500 CE, give or take a few centuries, depending on the region. Today, the word Celtic is nearly synonymous with Ireland, but the Celtic world originally encompassed what are now the British Isles, the Iberian Peninsula, and northern Italy, Switzerland, France, southern Poland, and central Turkey. Far from being a homogeneous culture, the Celtic world was home to a variety of languages, customs, and religious practices. It is sometimes wondered whether Ireland should be included under the Celtic umbrella, its own culture too different from other Celtic countries. Others argue that although Celtic cultures were quite different, similar burial rites and weaponry imply these far-flung communities held key core values. It's beyond the scope of this book to decide the matter, but for the sake of clarity, I will use the terms Celts or Celtic when discussing the overall Celtic world of this era, and Irish Celts, or Celtic Ireland, to describe the Irish people of the time. To understand any deity, it is best to attempt to know the culture from which they came. Unfortunately, we know very little about the Celts. Most descriptions came from their contemporaries, who likely did not understand the Celts or were wont to sensationalize details about them. To even say we know anything about the Celts is an exaggeration. Saying we guess is more accurate. Strangely enough, the mysteries surrounding the Celts may help us better accept and understand the mysteries around the Morrigan. Like many things about the Celtic world, the Morrigan's origins are cryptic. Other cultures, such as that of the Roman Empire, carved out specific roles for their gods. The gods of the Celts, however, were shifty and ambiguous. The religion of the Celts is believed to have been based on rituals, omen interpretation, magical spells, and avoidance of unlucky actions. But to date, no strong archaeological evidence exists for a Morrigan cult. Mythology of the era gives us the best glimpse into the Morrigan, but even this is challenged. The Celts did not keep written texts, preferring to preserve history and myth through oral tradition. Stories of the Morrigan and other Irish deities were preserved through manuscripts penned centuries after Ireland Christianized. Christian authors likely changed aspects of the gods to suit the new religion, or simply altered details they found frightening or unimportant. The Morrigan may have evolved from a collection of deities from different Irish Celtic tribes. These may have included prehistoric deities adopted by the Celts from earlier Irish inhabitants. While we may never know the Morrigan's specific origins, we do know that she is primarily an Irish goddess. Myths and effigies of some Celtic deities can be found across Europe, but the Morrigan is believed to be exclusively tied to Ireland. Her name offers more clues to her identity. Morgan Daimler writes in The Morrigan, Meeting the Great Queens, that a difference is revealed through the name's spelling. Morrigan, M-O-R-R-I-G-A-N, is Old Irish and likely means Nightmare Queen. Morrigan, M-O-R-R-I-G-A-N, and Morian, M-O-R-R-I-G-H-A-I-N, are later Irish versions that likely mean Great Queen. Other interpretations of her name include Queen of Phantoms, Sea Queen, or Queen of the Slain. Morrigan may also have been a generic title for a collection of goddesses. The Morrigan is associated with several names: Bive, Macha, Anu, Danu, Nevin, and Fia, all of whom are called the daughters of Earnmas. Little documentation exists for Earnmas, an obscure deity, although in some translations, Earnmas means murder. It's unclear whether these names referred to different aspects of the Morrigan or described distinctly independent characters. In earlier depictions, the Morrigan is defined as both a demonic flying creature and a member of a specific class of nasty beings. Despite these descriptions, it is unknown whether the Morrigan was feared by the Irish Celts, given that these writings were authored by Christians many centuries after the Celtic gods had been largely abandoned. Were the scribes of the new religion frightened of a divine female? Was this a misunderstanding of an older culture? Or was the Morrigan a monster, but loved and feared by the people who originally knew her? True to many aspects of the Morrigan, we will never have that answer. However, it's suspected that the Celts' relationship to their gods was not a loving one. Celtic gods were living embodiments of the natural world. Such gods could be benevolent, providing food and favorable weather. But they could also be fickle and violent, causing foul weather, disease, and famine. Worship of the gods was likely rooted in appeasement and distraction. Keep the gods happy, so they will leave us in peace. If this is true, the Morrigan would not have been uniquely or even especially vile. Any goddess with the power to influence the lives of mortal people would have occasionally been viewed as a fearful entity. Given that her name likely meant some form of queen, we can assume that she was believed to be greatly influential. The Great Queen of a Divine People. The Morrigan is one of the Tuatha De Danann, the people or tribe of the goddess Danu. The Tuatha De's original role in Celtic Irish faith is unknown. Depending on the tale, they were either gods, demigods, divine people, or a fairy race, who periodically aided humans for their own interests or amusement. In the myths, the Tuatha De arrived in Ireland on ships from the sky, granting the country great gifts of civilization. The Morrigan and her sisters Bive and Macha were among them. The Tuatha De completed the creation of the country before they were conquered by the sons of Mill, or Milesians, whom the myths describe as ancestors of the Celtic Irish. After this defeat, the Tuatha De retreated underground into the She Mounds, also called Fairy Mounds. The Tuatha De may have been an indigenous Irish people, mythologized over the centuries, who were replaced by or assimilated into groups who later arrived in Ireland. The church generally tolerated preservation of Irish mythology, so long as it was disguised as history. So, we do not know if the Tuatha De were meant to represent flesh and blood humans, or if they were always considered mythical. Therefore, we do not know if the Morrigan was ever meant to describe a historical queen, or if she was always considered a feature of myth. The Morrigan, one goddess or many? Is the Morrigan one goddess? Yes. Is the Morrigan one of several goddesses, all associated with the Morrigan? Yes. Is the Morrigan even a goddess at all, or a title for a group of goddesses? Yes and yes. Welcome to the first great paradox of the Morrigan. The singular versus multiple identity of the Morrigan incites online arguments and leaves would-be devotees scratching their heads. Which one is right? Can the Morrigan be one or many or both? Contemporary goddess worship is often divided into hard and soft polytheism. Hard polytheists are likely to view the Morrigan as a distinctly singular goddess. The other goddesses associated with the Morrigan, sometimes called the Morrigan sisters, are considered to be strictly separate entities. Soft polytheists might embrace the Morrigan sisters as interchangeable facets of one goddess, just as the facets of a diamond are all part of the same stone. If I had to pick a label, I would call myself a semi-hard polytheist. I approach the Morrigan sisters as individual entities, but sometimes I feel them all as one. It reminds me of my mother and her sisters. The women are very different, but being from the same family, they share strong similarities. At a family gathering, you might find them talking or laughing in such unison, they might as well be one person. Understanding the Morrigan as a single goddess, several goddesses, or another combination, is a personal experience. It's not the intention of this book to prove one over the other, nor should it be. For continuity, I will refer to the sisters as separate entities. Sometimes the myths are unclear as to whether the Morrigan is singular or a collection, and we must make our best guesses. The gods are, and always have been, enigmatic. Seeking to understand is part of human nature. But unraveling this conundrum is unnecessary. From the mystery comes the magic, and back to the mystery it returns. I would rather have mystery and the magic it provides than a solved mystery, leaving a magicless world. The Morrigan Sisters. The goddesses most frequently associated with the Morrigan are Bive, Macha, and Morrigu, also known as Morrigan. They are famous for being warlike furies, urging combatants to fight. Some writers have argued that the sisters were not so much goddesses as three sinister and destructive female beings who prophesied carnage and haunted battlefields. However, anything in triplicate, such as three sisters, within Celtic mythology, signified an exalted status. They could appear as crows, speaking to, inspiring, or contributing to the downfall of great characters and creatures, sometimes through a dark, mysterious language. The Morrigan sisters were often a unified force, but they each possessed unique powers. Bive, also known as Bov, may come from the Celtic Bodua, which means fighting lady. Bive signified rage, fury, or violence, and was described as both goddess and witch. Bive is known for being red-mouthed, a color that the Celts may have associated with death. She too could appear as a scald crow or carrion crow, and was sometimes called Ba-Kaha, the scald crow of battle, as Bive incited confusion within armies and reveled among the slain. She could inspire fear enough to cause insanity. The names of many Celtic goddesses reflected their relationship to humanity. Bive may have been a generic name for a war goddess, an alternative title for the three sisters, in this case referred to as Morrigu, Macha, and Neven, a term for a bad fairy, or a basic title for a frightening female character who issued prophecies of doom. Bive may be connected to the Banshee, a fairy whose appearance portends death. Like the Banshee, certain Bives were said to be attached to certain families, appearing as fateful omens in the shape of hooded crows. While all Morrigan sisters are known for foretelling, Bive's specific prophetic role involves warning of danger to come. She is fierce, but not evil. As a crow, Bive may take a mother goddess form who, even through bloodshed, was ultimately recovering her progeny. Her name, possibly used by early authors wishing to stress the most frightening aspects of the Morrigan. Modern manifestations of Bive may be unnerving, such as a dream of an impending death. They may also be helpful, such as a sudden urge to clutch your bag, only to discover that someone was planning to take your wallet. Bive may be a frightening Morrigan sister, but there is a role for scary goddesses. Sometimes, they're the best ones to walk us through scary times. Macha. Like Bive, Macha is associated with the crow and is sometimes described as a fury that riots and revels among the slain. Often described with red hair, Macha was a triple goddess in her own right. Sometimes depicted as one entity with three aspects, prophet, warrior, matriarch. She represented the sovereignty and fertility of Ireland, concerning herself with its welfare. Macha could be vengeful when wronged. She fought those who underestimated her because of her gender. In several myths, Hero's horses were called Macha's mare, or horse of Macha, suggesting that these mounts were dedicated to or blessed by her. She lived several different mortal experiences. She triumphed, she lost. She held power, she was brutally used. She experienced death numerous times, reappearing in other myths. Macha is sometimes considered a deified manifestation of the physical earth. Macha appeared as a queen of Ireland under the title of Macha Mongrua, or Macha Redmane. Macha may have been a generic title for a woman of power, a historic queen who legendarily ruled all of Ireland in 377 BCE, a pre-Celtic goddess adopted by the Irish Celts, or a sovereignty goddess of the Irish region of Ulster. While all three sisters have a potential function in any situation, the difference is their approach and the energy they bring to said situation. If Morrigan is the drive to move forward and Bive the warning to pull back, Macha reminds us to observe the immediate for obstacles and opportunities. Of the three, she is the one most experienced with human interactions and is often called upon for navigating hostile situations, helping to restore one's personal sense of power. Just as one must be in right relationship with a horse before riding it, Macha helps us be in right relationship with others. But even more importantly, she helps our relationships with ourselves. Morrigan or Morrigan? Morrigan or Morrigan was considered a queen among the gods, living in the Sidhe, the fairy places of the Tuatha De Danann. She was known for inciting battle, strife, and deeds of valor. She was also known for her wisdom, generosity, and prophetic abilities. She summoned kings into battle, strategized with gods, and stood with the slain. Morrigan offered morbid prophecies, cursed when insulted, and showed no mercy upon her enemies. She was also connected with wealth and fertility and with a generous and hospitable reputation. She was sometimes said to be even greater than the great god. Morrigan could appear as a beautiful woman, an ugly hag, or a scald crow. Her hair could be black, red, or gray. This is the sister who devotees generally, but not always, meet first in their Morrigan journeys. The myths of Morrigan, or Morrigan, shape the overall understanding of the sisters. She can be sought for strength, particularly when facing opposition. Because of her sexual encounters, she is sometimes sought out for matters of intimacy. Morrigan is the voice and energy of things that begin. She is the great conjurer of both magic and courage. She is the voice that lifts those who think they cannot go on. She is the spirit of determination and courage. Other names of the Morrigan. The following goddesses also appear alongside the Morrigan. It is beyond the scope of this book to delve deeply into them, but on your own Morrigan journey, you may come across them. Anu. Anu is sometimes believed to be an alternative name for Morrigan, also sometimes called Anna or Anan. Anu was a goddess of wealth and mother of the gods, said to have nursed the other deities. She is said to be another daughter of Ernmas. It is through Anu that the Morrigan is sometimes thought to be the wife of the Dagda, the good god of plenty. This sister might be approached for assistance with prosperity, healthy partnerships, parenting, and health. Danu, sometimes called Dana. Danu is another daughter of Ernmas. In some translations, her name meant sacred waters, and many rivers across Europe may have been named for her. The Tuatha De were named for her, as she was considered a mother or ancestor of the gods. Danu may have been the name of an earth goddess, or a title for the land itself. Danu may be an alternate name for Anu. Danu, Anu, and Ana may have been titles for a regional goddess, who grew into a more generalized one as time advanced. Danu may be consulted for help with the land, promoting bountiful gardens or farms, or assisting with favorable weather. Goddesses connected with water can also be sought for healing. Some traditions argue against consulting regional goddesses, like Danu, from afar. Others argue that the gods move with people and through migration, and deities like Danu find new homes far from their origins. This is another personal choice. A middle ground might be to approach Danu for help with connecting with a local, regional deity. Nevin, a shadowy early Irish war goddess, also represented by a crow. Nevin appeared alongside the Morrigan and Bive as a terrifying battle attendant. Nevin had the profound ability to confound armies, to the point that she was said to make even friendly bands slaughter one another. She was the wife or consort of the god Niet, as was Bive, whose identity she may share. Like Fia, Nevin might be useful in disarming an opposing force, but caution is again advised. Ancient, mostly unknown goddesses may have destructive elements long lost to modern devotees. This doesn't mean these goddesses should never be approached. Older, lesser-known goddesses can be eager to help, as devotion is what keeps them strong. A seeker curious about either Nevin or Fia might find it useful to sit with either or both goddesses, writing their names on an image printed from the internet, and lighting a candle nearby is an easy, effective devotional rite. Take note of how you feel. Strong, powerful feelings may indicate these goddesses can help you in a productive way. Creepy, panicky feelings, beyond the general nerves of working with new forces, are likely a warning against utilizing a deity. Fia. Called the Hateful, Fia was known for hovering over fighters, inspiring madness in battle, and reveling over the slain. She was frequently associated with or interchanged with Bive. In some stories, she was known as Nuada, one of the gods of the Tuatha De Danann. Fia might be sought out for channeling anger into action. She might be petitioned for help in thwarting an enemy or oppressor, but caution is advised. The frenzy of battle takes no sides. Using Fia to, say, thwart a landlord with intent to raise the rent might bring additional chaos. A middle ground might be to invoke Fia against that landlord when chaos is already abundant, such as when eviction is imminent. Inviting a goddess into their natural environment can be a helpful tool for navigating difficult situations. Connections with Morgan le Fay. As Christianity took hold in Ireland, many pagan gods and goddesses found new life as Christian saints or folklore heroes. One example is that of Brigid, also known as Brige, the pagan goddess whose myths remained largely intact when she became Saint Brigid. It's been suggested that the Morrigan became Morgan le Fay, the villainess of Arthurian legend. Morgan le Fay was known as a fairy enchantress of the mystical island of Avalon. She could shapeshift, heal, and cause strife between powerful people. She is sometimes associated with the raven and the ocean. For these reasons and for the similar name, she is often connected with the Morrigan. But the associations with the raven and the ocean and her magical ability may not be enough to confirm a connection. Raven imagery is found regularly in continental reliefs of female deities in British and continental Celtic mythology, and is not unique to the Morrigan. Shapeshifting is also a common ability among European deities. Although the names sound similar, if Morrigan means Great Queen, a similar etymology may have produced Morgan le Fay, supplying the character with a regal title, but not automatically connecting her to the Irish goddess. In addition, the Morrigan is solely Irish, while Morgan le Fay is English and Welsh. This does not mean that the Irish and British Celts never exchanged any sort of folklore, but the greater likelihood is coincidence, not connection. Still, many believe through their personal experiences that the Morrigan and Morgan le Fay are one and the same. Again, it is no one's place to label a personal experience as incorrect. But because the two are likely not connected historically, we will lovingly leave Morgan le Fay here and not include her as a Morrigan sister or aspect in this book. Why the Morrigan? Why now? The Morrigan was on my personal spiritual periphery for years. I've visited her sacred sites in Ireland, including several visits to Uaidh na Gcat, Cave of the Cats, where the myths say the Morrigan passes into the other world. I've honored her in rituals and prayed for her assistance with difficult matters. Still, I held her at a distance, as I'd heard too many warnings. She would take what she wanted from me. I could become ill. I might go insane. Sometimes, however, circumstances become so fraught we'd rather risk the side effects than avoid the medicine. When I got to that place, I approached the Morrigan. But what would she do to me? When I devoted myself to the goddess Brigid, I was a mess. I wanted to be a writer, but I could barely finish a blog post, let alone a book. I averaged 3 hours of sleep a night, working hard and partying harder. I was furtively dating a married man and hurting anyone who got in my way of getting what I wanted. Brigid entered my life like a sacred bulldozer, annihilating the relationship and exposing false friendships. The changes were hard, but worthwhile. I met my husband. I started a coven. I traveled. I wrote a book called Brigid, History, Mystery, and Magic of the Celtic Goddess, and another book after that. My life was gentler, more meaningful, and my purpose was clear. It's different now. I'm different now. I did not come to the Morrigan like a young tornado. My life was stable, my relationship solid, my health good. Yet, my soul was ragged. In a single year, I stepped down as high priestess of my coven, so bitterly burned out that I was on the verge of quitting magic and pagan spirituality completely. My husband and I moved 3,000 miles west from New York City, to a small town in rural Oregon. I'd hoped to spend the first few months settling into our new home and writing. Instead, I spent most evenings in one of many therapists' offices. An eating disorder I've battled since age 12 flared up, coupled with chronic depression I'd ignored for too long. Most painfully, a 2-year journey to heal an infertility issue hit a dead end. I found myself in a place so dark and deep that no one could reach me. That is where I found the Morrigan. At winter solstice, my husband and I traveled to Trout Lake Abbey, a druid sanctuary in Washington State, with a bottle of whiskey. The ground was thick with snow, the sky clear, and the winter sun setting. The abbey is home to spectacular shrines dedicated to different Celtic deities, including the Morrigan. I approached the Morrigan's shrine, tired and heartbroken, but not hopeless. With a glacial volcano bearing witness in the background, I poured the whole bottle out at the Morrigan's feet. In the twilight, the whiskey looked red upon the snow, mimicking the scenes of the wounded warriors on the shrine. I realized I was a wounded warrior too, but my injuries were of the heart. Inviting a goddess into a settled life is scarier than inviting one into chaos. How deep would the Morrigan go? Would she pick me apart like a raven on a corpse? What would she take from me? Would I recognize myself afterward? But in offering the whiskey on that cold night, I acknowledged my fears and proceeded anyway. This, I quickly realized, is an unofficial step in Morrigan devotion. The Morrigan is many things, but above all, she walks between the worlds of tangible and ill-defined. A goddess of the river Ford, she is the place where the improbable meets the possible. Just as the rushing waters surrounding a great ford are terrifying, so is she sometimes. But just as she stands in the ford connecting the dangerous with the safe, she crosses the gap between an old and new reality. We will not get through these lives of ours without facing the unknown and risking losing parts of ourselves in the process. Perhaps this is why she is the queen of nightmares. Just as bad dreams help us process trauma, stress, or confusing information, the Morrigan helps us navigate that which is beyond our ability to shape, control, or understand. At the same time, she invites controversy and fervent devotion that border on fanaticism. Heated schools of thought push narrow interpretations of who the Morrigan is and how she should be approached, based on ancient, cryptic descriptions. Because of this, many who desire to know the sisters shy away for fear of approaching them the wrong way. I struggled with this myself, initially. But the gods are and always have been reflections of human experience. They also grow and evolve as we do. The spirit of the old Celtic world is very much alive in contemporary Ireland. But no sane person would hop a flight to Galway and expect their bed and breakfast host to greet them with an iron sword and invite them on a cattle raid. Likewise, it makes no sense for modern devotees to cloister pagan gods in their ancient forms. Like us, they too have grown and changed. Then again, to best know the gods, it is important to know the history of the people who first honored them, the brutal parts alongside the beautiful. The world was quite different for humans 3,000 years ago. The choices they made to aid their survival might make contemporary people uncomfortable. Their gods and myths reflect that, and to sanitize these attributes would be inauthentic. We can't pick and choose truths about the gods and expect to ever know them fully, even if they don't suit most modern sensibilities. This book is a combination of the old and the new. It explores the oldest myths of the Morrigan, most of which may seem contradictory or even confusing at times. The messages of Celtic myth are often elusive and morally ambiguous. This may be because they were preserved centuries after they were first told by individuals disconnected from the context of the tale's era. Gemma McGowan, Irish witch and priestess, suggests that Irish myths are lessons on what not to do. They're misadventures designed to warn listeners against the hero's follies. Even with this helpful lens, there is still a great deal we will never understand about the myths. Throughout the book, we will work together to find our own understandings. I include many different interpretations for the stories, with the goal of opening the door to better understanding, but not to declare a true meaning for any of them. The stories may have been told for an ancient people several millennia ago, but they still hold answers for today's seekers. Your job is to embrace what makes sense to you in the moment, perhaps returning later to see how a different interpretation rests with you. The book also includes stories from contemporary people who have experienced the Morrigan. In each tale, the Morrigan has a hand in guiding people through their own personal mysteries and challenges. Some of these voices are native Irish, some are of Irish descent, and some have little or no ancestral links to Ireland at all. The Morrigan casts a wide net, pulling in devotees from all nations and backgrounds, led by an indelible familiarity known by people in ancient times and now. This book doesn't only cover lore and history. Each chapter includes a spiritual practice or exercise dedicated to knowing the Morrigan better. The entirety of Chapter 8 is focused on just that. While most exercises are accessible for magic or spiritual practitioners of any level, some require visioning techniques that newer practitioners might find challenging. If you find these difficult, I encourage you to be patient with yourself. All of them will eventually bring you deep experiences with the Morrigan, but some might need a few attempts to get the hang of them. Finally, I ask you to remember that I am an American, and therefore this book's reflections on Irish history, culture, and spirit come from a foreigner's perspective. For some reason, the Morrigan has collected me, as she has collected many others, and entrusted me with the opportunity to write this book. I won't pretend to understand the Morrigan's reasoning, but I can promise to share what I have learned about the sisters with respect, honor, and gratitude to the Irish people who opened their homes and hearts to me in completing this work. Let's begin. Ritual, meeting the Morrigan. Most mainstream faiths have templates for worship, but human-made templates to the Morrigan are scarce. Most modern devotees must create their own. Instead of seeing this as a restriction, embrace it as an opportunity to create beautiful spaces that reflect a unique spiritual journey. This section is devoted to building a spiritual space for working with the Morrigan. In a perfect world, we would each have a permanent space dedicated solely to our personal spiritual work. Frequently, this isn't feasible. Living spaces might be too small or cohabit.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.